Praise the Lord. So glad that everybody could log in tonight for another hour of Power Breakthrough Hour. Hope that you're having a great beginning of the week. Hope that everybody's doing wonderful. So glad that you support us every week, man. You guys are so wonderful. Remember, you can also catch our YouTube videos on YouTube. Certainly feel free to go there and check out our content at youtube.com. You can type in Pastor Jamar Phil, y'all, or Flowing Rivers Ministries. Make sure that you like and subscribe to our channel. We love your support. We're so glad that you're helping us get this word of God out to the world and to the body of believers. We are so delighted that we're coming to actually the end of our series of Let's Get Better. This will be the final installment tonight of our Corinthians Church series. I hope that you've learned a whole lot. I know I have. About Paul's, the Apostle Paul's letter to the Corinthian church and the etiquette and the behaviors that he wanted us to have as becoming believers and as members of the bodies of Christ. And so I hope that you've enjoyed it. I know I have. Tonight we have a banger for you as we're going out with a great word of encouragement and edification. So I hope you brought your Bibles with you tonight, maybe even a cup of tea. Hopefully you told a friend to log on, and let's get this word. Let's get down in this word, and we're going to end with a power-packed prayer from Sister Tate as usual. And I hope that everybody is excited about it. I know I am. Let's go to the book of 1 Corinthians tonight. Don't want to hold you too long, but we're going to chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're ending tonight. We're ending tonight. Let's get better. I hope that everybody is getting better. Let's get better for Jesus Christ. Let's get better for Jesus. So we're coming tonight to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And our subtopic tonight is there is hope beyond the grave. That's our subtopic tonight. That there is hope beyond the grave. Write that down. There is hope. There is hope beyond the grave. Many people are worrying about what happens after this life. You notice in the last few years, we've lived through pandemics. We've lived through family members dying. We've lived through getting older ourselves. Some of us have had sicknesses and frailties, and we've often wondered what happens beyond the grave. Of course, you know, for non-believers, there is no hope. There is no hope beyond the grave. You're lost forever. There's no way to sugarcoat that. You don't believe in Jesus Christ. There is no forgiveness for your sins. Sin is the only thing that separates anybody from God. And there has to be a payment for your sin. And that payment only comes through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And if you have not accepted him as your Lord and Savior, if you don't believe Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then you're going to be lost. So I want to dive into this a little bit tonight, because we understand that happens for sinners, but there's something else that happens for those of us who believe in Jesus Christ. And the Apostle Paul has done such a wonderful, wonderful job throughout this book of starting out with the doctrine of what we are as becometh believers. He establishes that we are safe in Jesus Christ if we believe in him. And then he goes into our behaviors, that there should be a certain behavior of becometh believers in Christ. There are certain behaviors that you should not do. There are certain things that you should not be doing as becometh believers in Jesus Christ. But then he also gets to the things that we should be doing. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, there's some things you should be doing, and there's some things you should not be doing. And 1 Corinthians presents a wonderful, wonderful example of becoming believers and in the body of Christ of what we should and should not be doing. But then he gets to this end part right here, and he begins to tell us again, what we should be looking for in the future. By being established in Jesus Christ, you should be looking for a bright future, a bright future. Your future is bright. Your future is so bright, you need to wear shades. Your future is so bright, you should be smiling and excited every day. Your future is so bright that there should not be a day that you don't give God praise. Lift up your hand and tell the Lord, thank you for what he's done for your life. And that's what the Apostle Paul is reestablishing before he ends this letter. That there's some things you should not be doing. There's some things that you definitely should be doing. But even in all of that, if you believe in Jesus Christ, there is a future for you that's very bright. So let's dive in real quick to 1 Corinthians 15. I'm going to begin at verses 1 through 3. I'm going to read this part from the New Living Translation, and I'm going to read some other parts from the New King James Version. But here in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 3 of the New Living Translation, Paul says, Let me remind you, in case you forgot, dear brothers and sisters, of the good news, the gospel, I preached to you before. You welcomed it then, and you still stand firm in it. Verse 2, it is the good news that saves you if you continue to believe in the message I told you. Unless, of course, you believe something that never was true in the first place. Here he's reminding the believers there in Corinth. He says, I want to remind you of what we started with. Out of all this I preached to you in this letter, let's go back to the basics. Let's go back to our first love, which is the gospel of Jesus Christ. I want to state that tonight because there's so many people that are hearing so many different messages about what being a Christian is. You have it through your own churches. We have it through our local churches. And of course, we have it on the internet, all over television. There's so many different messages that you can possibly hear on a week-to-week basis. But the Apostle Paul says, out of all these messages, I want to remind you of the foundation, what I first taught you. I want to take you back to the original masterpiece of what we're doing. And that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. Regardless of what is going on around you, never forget the gospel. This is what you're going to pass down to your children, to your children's children, is what you're going to pass to your neighbors, people that you meet on the street. We may not have a long conversation, but if there's any chance for me to give you the gospel, that is what I want to give you that will help you for the rest of eternity, the gospel. And he dives right in here in verse 3. Here it is. Verse 3, he says, I passed on to you what was most important and what had also been passed to me. This is the important thing. This is it. That Christ died for our sins, just as the scripture said. He was buried and he was raised from the dead on the third day, just as the scripture said. Verse 5 says, he was seen by Peter and then the 12. After that, he was seen by more than 500 of his followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he was seen by James and later all the apostles. Verse 8, last of all, as though I had been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. For I am the least of all the apostles. In fact, I'm not even worthy to be called an apostle after the way I persecuted the church. Now, the Apostle Paul is letting us know here the central theme of the gospel. It's not what you wear. It's not any of these rules, these dogmatic rules that people want to add on to the gospel. Of course, there is etiquette, and the Apostle Paul, he let us know what the etiquette was, how we should live as we studied the past 10 weeks. But he says, let's get back to the basis of the central theme of our gospel, which is that Jesus died for our sins. That's number one. Jesus Christ, as a sinless Son of God, took our punishment for our sins. Jesus Christ, as the Son of God, a sinless Son of God, took our punishment for our sins. So those who believe in him can have their sins removed. My sins don't belong to me anymore. They are gone. They're gone. My sins are removed from me simply because I believe in Jesus Christ. You can reference Ephesians chapter 2 when you get to read it on your own time, especially verses 8 and 9. And you can see where Jesus Christ, simply by believing in him, by having faith in him, our sins are removed. This was prophesied by the prophet Isaiah many years before Jesus came to the earth. In Isaiah 53, verses 5 through 6 in the New King James Version, the Bible says that Isaiah prophesied that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So God saw fit that he had a plan for us long before that the earth was even formed. That there was sin that was to come into the earth that he forms, that he was going to have a way out for us. And he sent his own son, Jesus Christ, to take our sins on the cross. This was God's plan, that he would take our sins on the cross, that he would be tortured for us, and that he would be able to be a sacrifice, a blood sacrifice, for the removal of the sins of those who believe in him. I'm talking about total removal, no stain. Though your sins may be red as crimson, God had a plan that was going to wash us whiter than snow. Now, to solidify it, that he died, because you know, we live in this time now, people, it's hard for them to believe that somebody died and rose again. But God showed so many witnesses after he was risen again that this is true. That you can believe that Jesus Christ has died, watch this, and he was buried. He died and he was buried. He was put in a tomb of the man by the name of Joseph of Arimathea. He owned the tomb and he asked for Jesus's body and they buried him in the tomb. I'm talking about Jesus was really dead. Now, there were some that tried to spread lies that this thing didn't really happen like they do today. And this is getting worse now, it seems, than what it was many years ago, that you're actually seeing people rebel against the fact that Jesus Christ died and was buried and was risen from the dead. So again, Paul is stating here that Jesus Christ died, he was buried, and we know he was risen because we all saw him in his resurrected body. We saw him. He was in the grave from Friday afternoon till Saturday morning, 3 days, and he rose again, and he was saw by Peter and the rest of the 12 apostles. He was saw by more than 500 believers at one time, and at that time in AD, I think it's around 56, the Apostle Paul says, some of the people are still alive, from AD 33. They're still alive. And he says that they saw him, and not only Peter, the 12, and the 500 believers, but also James, the Lord's brother, and all the other apostles, as well as myself. Paul said, I saw him in a special and unique way. He showed himself to me that he was really alive. I saw his real body. And he says, I want you to know this because there are many that are going around saying this is not real. And this is the most important part of the gospel. This is the gospel that I need you to hold on to, because there's something that you can expect if you will hold on to your faith. I don't know what somebody's going through tonight. I don't know what you've been through, but there's going to be a blessing that's coming for you if you will hold on to your faith that Jesus Christ died for you, that he was buried for you, and that he rose again for you, and that he's coming back for those who have put their trust and faith in him. I'm talking about you believe in that fact more than life itself. Paul said, I need you to stand on it. We got witnesses. We got witnesses that he was dead. We got witnesses that he was put in a tomb, that he was there from Friday afternoon till Sunday morning. He was there. Roman officers were around the tomb. Nobody could get in to steal the body. But all of a sudden, one day, Mary shows up and the tomb has been rolled away and the body is gone. And there's an angel there that begins to speak to Mary. Oh God, I wish I had somebody. That he said, you can trust in what we're telling you, that we're giving you inside information that Jesus gave to his believers. He showed himself to us. He sat down and ate fish with us. He showed Thomas the nail prints in his hand. Thomas was able to touch the nail prints in his hand. Thomas was able to touch the piercing in his side. He was able to touch his body. Jesus was able to cook breakfast for the disciples. Oh man, they had fellowship with Jesus for 40 days after he was risen from the dead. 40 days. And then they saw him go to the Mount of Olives and ascend back up into heaven, where he now is at the right hand of God. The Apostle Paul says, I need you to believe this. I need you to hold on to this. No matter how hard trying times get, I need you to hold on to the gospel. If anybody ever asks you what the gospel is, you take them here to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that Jesus Christ lived a sinless life. He was born of a Virgin Mary. He lived a sinless life. He was crucified and put in a grave for 3 days. Oh God, I wish I had somebody. While he was living, he worked miracles. While he was living, he walked on water. He healed the sick, cast out devils. Oh God. But he was a sinless sacrifice for us that they killed and tortured, killed on a cross, crucified him on the cross, put him in the grave. And in 3 days, he rose again with all power and was seen by many people. Over 500 people saw Jesus walking on the earth alive. Not dead. Somebody, that's why I said, he's alive. My God is alive. He lives. Every other false god is dead. But my God, Jesus, he rose from the dead.
Yes.
And was seen by more than 500 people with the nail print still in his hand. With the nail print still in his feet.
My God.
The piercing holes still in his side. He still carries the bruises that he took for your sin and my sin. Oh God, we're talking about a risen Savior. And then they saw him rise again 40 days. They saw him go up to heaven 40 days after he had rose from the dead. And the angels told the people there, why do you sit here gazing? The same way that you've seen him ascend is the same way that Jesus is coming back. The same way that he went back to heaven for us, he's coming back to get us. This is the gospel of victory. So as we go, let's go a little bit further. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 15 and 20. 1 Corinthians 15 and 20. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15 and 20 says, Paul says, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Verse 21. So you see, just as death came into the world through one man, talking about Adam, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man, talking about
Jesus.
Verse 22 says, just as everyone dies because we belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. All right? So I love what Paul is saying here, because there's hope beyond the grave for the believers of this great gospel of Jesus Christ.
Well, yes, there is.
Jesus, when he rose again, he's the first part of a harvest. He's the first part of the harvest of resurrected believers.
Mm-hmm.
He's the first one, and guess who's going to be next? It's going to be us.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
It's going to be everybody that's dead in the grave, everybody that's given their life to Christ and have died from this earth. They're going to be the next part of the harvest of resurrected people. Now, this is so important because Jesus is the first part of the harvest, and it represents, as the Jews used to bring the first part of the harvest to the temple as an offering. You can see that in Leviticus chapter 23. That there was always the best part, glory to God, the best part of the harvest that was sacrificed to the temple. Oh God, I want to help you, help somebody here. If you go all the way back to Cain and Abel, you'll see where Abel brings a better sacrifice to God and Cain held back the better part. And so God recognize Abel's sacrifice because it was the better sacrifice. It was the best part of the sacrifice. Glory to God. And so Cain got mad and slayed his brother Abel because God loved Abel's sacrifice better. But look what God does here with Jesus. When Jesus raises from, when he rises from the dead, he's the first part. But we're coming after Jesus. We're the next part of the sacrifice. But I want to tell somebody, the best part has already been offered to God. I wish I had somebody. God said, I'm going to use him as the sacrifice to myself on behalf of the people's sins. And when he rises from the dead, he's going to be the very best part of the harvest that is to come. Oh, I want to tell somebody that Jesus is not just like us. Hallelujah. He's better than us. He's the best part of the harvest. He's God in the flesh that came to the earth to die for human people like us. Oh, we're coming up. We're coming up next. But God said, I need the best part first. Glory to God. And so he raised Jesus Christ from the dead first. And he took the best part of the new harvest of resurrected believers first. And he says that those who are in Christ, those who that give themselves to Christ, they're going to come next. And I'm going to give them the same harvest, oh God, the same blessing that I gave Jesus Christ. That's why Paul says in Romans, he says that Romans chapter 8, that we are heirs to God, meaning that we're getting an inheritance from God. He says, but we are joint heirs with Jesus Christ, meaning that we're getting the harvest that Jesus gets because we are in Christ. We're joint heirs in Jesus Christ. And so he says, but Jesus has to come first because he is sinless. And I made him sin. I made sin, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I made him sin, and I made him a sin offering so that you could be righteous who believe in him, and you can receive the next part of this inheritance. Oh, God, I wish I had somebody. Oh, God. He says, so Jesus, he's the best sacrifice, and he's going to receive the inheritance first. He says, but you're coming up next as the best part of the resurrected bodies, and you're going to receive an inheritance that Jesus receives. Now, the first part of this inheritance that you receive is the Holy Spirit. That's the first part of the inheritance, Ephesians chapter 1. You can see that he says the Holy Spirit will seal you for the day of redemption. And this is the earnest or the guarantee, glory to God, of the rest of the inheritance that you will receive when you're resurrected from the dead. I want to talk to somebody tonight about the gospel. Glory to God. You're going to receive the Holy Spirit first as the earnest or the down payment. The down payment for the rest of the inheritance that you're going to receive once you're resurrected from the dead to eternal life. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He said, but I got to give it to Jesus first.
Yeah.
My. He's got to be the first partaker of what's to come for you, because everything that I did for Jesus is going to be what I'm going to do for you. I wish I had somebody on this line that know Jesus Christ. He says, I want you to take thought of everything that I gave Jesus, I'm going to give to you. If I rose Jesus from the dead, I'm going to raise you from the dead. If I gave Jesus eternal life, I'm going to give you eternal life. The thing that I gave Jesus, I'm going to give to you.
So hallelujah.
He brings us here to 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 42. Let's go to 42. I'm trying to hasten through this tonight. Verse 42 through 49, I'm going to bring it all together at the end. And I'm going to read a little bit here. Verse 42 says in the New Living Translation, it was the same way with the resurrection of the dead. Our earthly bodies are planted in the ground when we die, but they will be raised to live forever. Verse 43, our bodies are buried in brokenness, but they will be raised to glory. They are buried in weakness, but they will be raised in strength. They are buried as natural human bodies, but they will be raised as spiritual bodies. Or just as there are natural bodies, there are also spiritual bodies. Verse 45 says, the scripture tells us, the first man, Adam, became a living person. But the last Adam, that is Christ, is a life-giving spirit. Verse 46, what comes first is the natural body, what we see now. Then the spiritual body comes later. Adam, the first man, was made from the dust of the earth, while Christ, the second man, came from heaven.
Well, thank you, Jesus.
Earthly people are like the earthly man, and heavenly people are like the heavenly man. Just as we are now like the earthly man, watch this, y'all. Just as we are now like the earthly man, we will someday be like the heavenly man. Oh, God, I wish I had somebody. Okay, in other words, if you're a believer in Christ, just as our present bodies die and decay in the grave, when Jesus comes back, he will raise our bodies to new bodies. He'll raise us from earthly bodies to heavenly bodies.
Oh, yes, Lord.
From mortal bodies to immortal bodies that will be perfect bodies that will never decay. Mm-hmm. Our new bodies will defy the laws of nature. If somebody's sick on the line tonight, I got hope for you. I got some good news for somebody who's sick. I got some good news for somebody whose body is weak. I have good news for somebody whose body has been suffering, whether it's mental, physical, emotional. I have some good news for you, that one day God is going to give you a new body, and everything that is weak or sick with your current body is going to be vanquished. Mm-hmm. It's going to be removed. God is going to raise you to a new body that can never get sick. Glory to God. He's going to raise you to a new body that's going to be stronger than it's ever been. He's going to raise you to a new body. You're going to see better than you've ever seen. You're going to be stronger than you've ever been. I don't care if you lift weights like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I don't care if you can punch like Muhammad Ali. I don't care if you can run like Carl Lewis. I don't care if you can shoot a basketball like Michael Jordan. I don't care if you are smart as Einstein. You're going to be greater than any human body that has ever walked the earth. Glory to God. God said, I'm raising you to a heavenly body. If you'll just hold on to the gospel of truth, there is a reward for you beyond the grave. And I know it's sad when we see our loved ones dying and going in the grave, and it seems like that things are going to stay this way forever. But Jesus has given us the responsibility to preach the gospel, that there is something beyond the grave. And if you are in Christ, there is hope beyond the grave. Oh God, you might have died in a sickness, but God said, when I raise you up, sickness is going to be over. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. I'm telling you right now that this new body is just like a seed going into the ground. When you put a seed in the ground, you can't tell what that seed is going to be. I remember being in agriculture growing up with some of my family members, and they had fields and gardens, and they would go to the store and buy seed to put in the ground. Sometimes it would be corn seed, or it would be bean seed, butter beans, string beans, or peppers, or squash, okra, whatever it was. And that seed never looked like what the finished product was going to be. It was just a seed going in the ground. And Paul, if you go back and read chapter 15 here on your own time, you'll see where he compares our earthly body to a seed and our resurrected body to the finished product. I wish I had somebody. He said, you need to see it as something like a seed going into the grave. Like a pear seed. If you want a pear tree, you have to first put the seed in the ground. And at the right time, the pear tree will raise up to be a big tree that's bigger than a human being or bigger than a house. And it'll be pears that'll just be hanging off the tree that people can eat from. Well, Paul uses this example because he wants us to know that these bodies that we have on earth cannot be compared to the resurrected heavenly bodies that are going to be raised when Jesus Christ comes back. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He said, this current body that you have is like a seed. He said, but your resurrected body, I want you to imagine it like a big cedar tree. Glory to God. A tree that's tall and strong, and the branches are strong, and the tree trunk is strong, and the roots are deep. You couldn't tell it from the seed. Glory to God. He said, but by the time I got finished with the seed was something that was could not be imagined with the eye. And he said, that's a part of the gospel. Don't let nobody tell you that there is not hope beyond the grave. He said that there is hope beyond the grave because I'm about to give you an inheritance that your mind can't even conceive. It's too big for your mind. Oh, glory to God. It's too big for you to even be able to conceive with your natural mind. I'm talking about you're going to be so big that your mind can't conceive it. You're going to be so strong, your mind can't conceive it. You're going to run so fast, Your mind can't conceive it. God said, I'm giving you a heavenly body. Oh, glory to God. I wish I had somebody. I'm giving you a heavenly body. He said, not only am I giving you peace, but I'm going to give you a new body. I'm going to give you some new eyes. I'm going to give you some new ears. You're going to hear better than you ever heard. You're going to communicate better than you ever communicated. He says, so I give you a peek into it. Oh, let me break this down here. He says, I give you a peek into it by the down payment of the Holy Spirit. Oh, y'all ain't going to say nothing here. So when you get deep into prophecy, he says, and you have the gift of prophecy, you're able to defy natural laws of the body. Oh, glory to God. You'll hear God when everybody else can't hear him. You can see in the spirit when everybody else can't see. Oh, God, you can lay hands on us. You can speak the things and they have to obey. Just like Jesus spoke to the fig tree and the fig tree had to die. He said, I'm giving you a peek. Anybody that has the Holy Spirit has already peeked into the spiritual realm and the spiritual body. Because there should be some things that you are doing in the spirit that should defy the laws of science. Oh, glory to God. I'll give you discernment. I'll let you know things that other people don't know. Oh, yes, Lord. I'll let you speak in a language of the kingdom that everybody can't speak with their natural mind. I'll let you be able to interpret the secret and the mysteries of the spirit realm. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. I'll let you be able to defy the laws of science and work miracles. That's why Elijah could call for rain and he could shut the rain up as well. That's a peek into the heavenly body. That's a peek into the heavenly body. That's why Moses could raise up the staff and the water, the Red Sea begin to raise up on both sides. That's a peek into the spiritual realm. Oh, y'all ain't gonna say nothing to me here. Hallelujah. That's why Joshua, when they got to the River Jordan had to lift up at the Spirit of God. Because when you got the Holy Ghost, you get a peek into the spiritual realm. That's why, like, 5'5" David, hallelujah, just a small shepherd boy could go against a giant named Goliath and slay him with a stone because it's a peek into the spiritual realm. Because we're in the spiritual realm, it defies the laws of science. Your body will do things that the natural person should not be able to do.
Yes.
God said, I'm giving you a peek into it. I'm giving you a peek into it. Jesus said, I'm going to show you I can walk on water.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus said, I'm going to show you I can take 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread and feed over 5,000 people. Jesus said, I'm going to show
Hallelujah.
Miracles. He said, because in the heavenly body, in the heavenly realm, you're going to be able to do things that you could never imagine in the earth realm. God said, this is the inheritance I'm giving you, a new body. So let's finalize this here. Let's bring it to a close. Let's go to verse 51, 1 Corinthians 51. Let's bring this to a close. So the Apostle Paul says, it's coming. So he said, I'm so sure it's coming. In verse 51, he says, let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. In other words, in the King James Version, he says, let me show you a mystery, something that has not been revealed to humanity, but God has given it to me. In the New Living Translation, it says, we will not all die, but we will be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed. Verse 53, for our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, the scripture is fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death. But the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's letting us know here that he talks about pretty much what we hear is the rapture. Some of us will be dead in the grave. And when Jesus comes back, we're going to rise from the grave first. But then there'll be some that believe in Jesus Christ, and they will be living on earth at the current time. And he says these Christians will be caught up, that when the trumpet blasts, immediately they will be transformed into heavenly bodies. Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Immediately after the trumpet is sounded, you're going to go from mortal to immortal bodies. The Bible says that the trumpet must come first. Now, this is important because the Jews understood the significance of the trumpet. In Numbers 10 and 10, you can see where that the trumpets were always blown to signal the start of great festivals or to signal the start of extraordinary events. Before they started a great festival, they would blow the trumpet. Before an extraordinary event started, a trumpet is blown. You know, for years, I used to hear this story, and they used to make it almost sound scary, some people, because they would say, oh man, when the trumpet is sounded, oh man, you better hope that you're ready. But this is, Paul is not saying this to scare you. He's talking to believers to let them know that a festival is coming, that a party is coming. In other words, to make it plain, when the trumpet is sounded, he's letting the world know for the believers, it's party time.
Glory to God.
He's letting us know that when the trumpet sound, when you hear the trumpet sound for the believers who are dead in the grave, you're going to hear it too. And for the believers who are walking the earth, he's letting them know, I'm back and it's time to have a party. It's time to have a good time because death is over. The sting of death is over. And now you're about to be raised to a life of joy and peace and eternalism. He's going to raise you to the place that you're going to see such greatness that you've never seen in your life. I'm talking to somebody who wants Jesus tonight. Glory to God. I'm telling you that there is no hope in no other God. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight on this internet, but I'm telling you, wherever you are, that your time is almost up if you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ. You don't have a party to look forward to. All you have to look forward to is hell, fire, and brimstone. But for those who have given their life to Jesus Christ, you just hold on a little while longer. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight. I'm telling you, they may kill the body, but God said, don't worry about those who can kill the body. He said, only concentrate on the one who can destroy the soul and the body. But Jesus says to us tonight, oh, through the Apostle Paul, that there are good times that are coming to the Christian believers beyond the grave. I want to tell somebody tonight that there's joy beyond the grave. There is power beyond the grave. That there is new life beyond the grave. Ah, I wish I had somebody that's going to hold on to their faith, even if it cost them their life. No matter what's going on in the earth realm, I want you to remember the gospel that Jesus Christ has come to live a sinless life, and he died on the cross and was buried in a grave. And in 3 days, he rose again as the first part of the harvest. in which you are to come as well. I want somebody on this line, if you're not saved, to get saved tonight. Oh, we'll walk you through the sinner's prayer. We'll walk you through it. You can call us. You can email us. We'll contact you because you need to be saved. You don't want to miss this party. I'm talking about it's going to be the party of parties. Everybody's going to be there. I heard Moses is going to be there. I heard Jacob is going to be there. I heard Abraham is going to be there. Oh, but I want to see the main attraction. Oh, when I see Jesus in the house. Handa Bahushanda, I want them to sound the music. Turn up the music a little bit louder. Oh, back in the day, I'm from the 80s. Back in the day when they pumped up the music, we used to tell them to pump up the volume. Yes, Lord, pump the volume up. Turn the sound up. I'm glad to see you, Solomon. I've been waiting to see what you look like. I'm glad to see you, David. I've been waiting to see what you look like. And Elijah, I've studied you for years, and I'm glad to see you in the house. But oh, can somebody tell me where Jesus is? Oh, I wish I had somebody. Ikanamahaya, the one who paid the price for me to get into the party. Can somebody tell me where Jesus is? The one who shed his blood and paid for my ticket to be here. Can somebody tell me where Jesus is? The one who was nailed in his feet, hallelujah, just so I could be and have a seat at the table. Can somebody tell me where Jesus is? The one who put the crown of thorns on his head, just so I could be in the building and partake in the dinner for the believers of God. I come to tell you there's only one way to get a ticket. Hallelujah. And the only way you can get in the party, you got to give your hallelujah. The Apostle Paul said, for those who hold on till the end. Has somebody been telling you to leave God? Somebody said you ought to try a little bit of Muhammad. Somebody said you ought to try a little bit of Buddha. Somebody said you ought to try a little bit of Hinduism. But I come tonight as the trumpet of God to sound the alarm, to tell you don't lose your seat in the house. Don't you lose your seat in the party of God. You ought to come to Jesus just like you are. I don't care if you're a fornicator. I don't care if you're an adulterer. I don't care if you're a witch or a warlock. You need to lay your crystals down. You need to lay your down. Glory to God. You need to lay down your doll babies. Glory to God. You need to lay down your hatred. You need to lay down your lying. You need to lay down your sin. Glory to God. And you need to come to Jesus just as you are. And the Lord said, I'll save you and I'll clean you up and I'll make you just right for the party. I shed enough blood so that you can get in the party. Hallelujah. I don't care if you're black. I don't care if you're white, Puerto Rican, Haitian. I don't care if you're Japanese, Asian. I don't care what you are. Jesus said, I paid the price for you to get in the party. Matter of fact, Jesus said, hallelujah, whosoever will, let them come. I want them all there. He said, I want my party full, but there is room, hallelujah, in heaven for you. There's room in heaven for you. There's room in heaven for your children. There's room. There's room in heaven for your neighbor. There's room in heaven for your classmate. There's room in heaven for your coworker. There's room in heaven for everybody if they'll come to Jesus just as they are. Hallelujah. Submit to Jesus Christ. Give your life to him because there's only one way to heaven. One way, one way, one way, one way. There is no other way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can get to God except through me. Nobody can come to the Father except through me. He said, and everybody that the Father gives me, he said, no man can pluck them out of my hand. Oh, I wish I had somebody. And nobody can pluck them out of my Father's hand. He said, because I'll seal you up and make you ready for the party. I wish I had somebody on this line that's getting ready for the party. Hallelujah. I can only imagine that the table's going to be spread. Oh, hallelujah. God. When I look over there, I'm going to see Mary Magdalene at the party. I wish I had somebody. When I look over there, I'm going to see Esther and Deborah at the party. I wish I had somebody. When I look on the other side, I'm going to see Anna at the party. Glory to God. When I look on this side over here, I'm going to see Lydia at the party. Wonderful. Hallelujah. And it ain't going to be the women on one side and the men on the other. But we'll all be at the table where the table is spread. And guess who's going to be at the head of the table? Hallelujah. It's going to be Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He gets the head table. He gets the head seat. Hallelujah. We worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. He gets the best part of the food. He gets the best part of the praise. Hallelujah. And hallelujah.
Yes, he gets.
I'm gonna tell you right now, for those of you who think it's going to be a quiet party, you might as well get ready to stay home. Hallelujah. This is going to be a loud party. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. And you're going to look over there and you think you saw how to dance. I can't wait to see David dancing at the party. Y'all ain't going to say nothing to me yet. I'm going to try to see if I can dance like David danced. Anybody gonna be at the party dancing like David, singing like David? Glory to God. Hallelujah. I'ma sing for Jesus. Hallelujah. The best I've ever sung before. I might not be a singer, but with my new body, I believe I'll be able to sing. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing to me. I might not be a dancer, but with my new body, I believe I'm gonna be able to dance. Glory to God. I wish I had somebody. I came to encourage somebody tonight that there's hope beyond the grave. Hallelujah. You might pass by the graveyard and it might look dark and it might look dim, but my Jesus has promised that the same way he left is the same way that he's coming back. Hallelujah. And when he comes back, he said, I'm giving you a new body, a body you can party with me with. Glory to God. A body you can praise me with. Hallelujah.
Body
will never be able to die again. Hallelujah. But I'm giving you an eternal body that'll never go to another grave. Oh, I wish I had somebody. Glory to God. Jesus said, I'm coming back for a church. Hallelujah. That's going to worship me forever. Glory to God. I'm coming back for a church. Hallelujah. That's going to worship me. Hallelujah. Till there is no end. And when these earthly tents be dissolved, hallelujah, when these earthly tents are taken down, you can rejoice because you got a home on the other side. I wish I had somebody, glory to God. And the home on the other side, hallelujah, your street gonna be on streets of gold. Hallelujah, glory to God. Hallelujah, you're gonna be on Gold Street. A place where there is no dirt, a place where there is no sin, a place where there is no decay, a place where the sun will shine forever. There's hope beyond the grave. Don't you let it ever scare you another night about a grave. A grave ain't got no power on you. Glory to God. Oh, death, where is your sting? Hallelujah. Grave, where is your victory? You lost your victory. The devil thought he had it, hallelujah, when Adam sinned, hallelujah. But he didn't know that God was on the way, hallelujah, with another solution. He didn't, I feel like it tonight, I'm just out here. He didn't know that God was on the way, hallelujah, with another solution. That God had a solution beyond death. He didn't know that God had a solution beyond the decay. Beyond the maggot. I'm telling you that the maggot's going to have to give up your skin. The dust's going to have to give up your bones. Hallelujah. The dirt in the grave going to have to give up your body. Because God said, I'm taking that body and I'm raising it up to a new body. Hey, glory to God. I wish I had somebody. Hallelujah. That know that they in the number. Hallelujah. I remember my grandma used to sing a song. My grandma used to say, I'm glad to be in the number one more time. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I come to tell somebody tonight that John said, I saw a number that I could not number.
Hallelujah. I saw a number that was too great for me to count, that they were from every tribe and every culture. They were from every ethnicity. Hallelujah. I come to tell you that John saw a number that he could not number. I wish I had somebody on the line that would raise their hand, say, I'm in the number. Hallelujah. I might not be the number one person. I might not be the number two person. I might not be number 100. I might not be number 1,000. I might not even be number 1 million. But I'm so glad that I'm in the number. Hallelujah. I might not be, hallelujah, in the top 10 of who's who for Christians. I might not be in the top 25. I might not be in the top 100. But I'm so glad that I'm in the number. Hallelujah. There's hope beyond the grave. Hallelujah. I'm going to march with the saints. My grandma used to say, when the saints go marching in, hallelujah. Hey, I wish I had somebody. Hallelujah. When the saints, hallelujah, I'm going to be in that number. Not because I deserve it. Hallelujah. Not because I did so good, but it was by the blood of Jesus Christ. Anybody was by the blood. It was by the blood of Jesus that every drop of blood had your name on it. Hallelujah. Every drop of blood had your forgiveness on it. Hallelujah. Every drop of blood had your redemption on it. Hallelujah. Every drop of blood. Every drop of blood that fell from his head. Every drop of blood that fell from his feet, every drop of blood that fell from his side, it had your forgiveness. Every drop of blood was your ticket. Glory to God. Every drop, he was dropping tickets out. Hallelujah. For everybody that would receive him. Every drop of blood had your name on it. Every drop of blood had your reservation on it. Every drop of blood gave you VIP status. Glory to God. Every drop of blood, every drop of blood, every drop of blood that he took, hallelujah, glory to God, from Pilate's house all the way up to Golgotha. He took every drop of blood. Glory to God. As he dripped the blood, hallelujah, on his way to Calvary's cross. Hallelujah. It paid your ticket. Anybody on the line know, hallelujah, it ain't about how good you've been, hallelujah, because your goodness are as filthy rags, but it's about the goodness of Jesus and all that is done for me. My soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for saving me. Sister Tate, this is in your hands. Sister Tate, will you give us some prayer? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Somebody give God a prayer.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, in the name of Jesus, give you glory.
There's hope beyond the grave. There's hope.
Hallelujah. You serve, oh God, tonight. Hallelujah. Another part of let's get better.
Hallelujah.
Another part of let's get better. There's hope beyond the grave. My God, hallelujah. Pastor Ma has come on with these hallelujah topics. Hallelujah. Let's get better from time to time. And he told us what we got to do to get better. And tonight, hallelujah, we understand that there's hope beyond the grave. We know that one day we got to get out of here. We've gone through a lot of things and we're going through many things. One day it's going to be all over and we'll be able to go to live with Jesus forever.
Hallelujah.
He paid the price for us on the cross of Calvary, and he rose again that we might be able, hallelujah, to live with him, so we don't have to worry, hallelujah, about dying and about death coming about, because there's a better day coming after a while. A better day is coming in the kingdom. Many of us have lost loved ones through the COVID, hallelujah. We've lost our loved ones, hallelujah, but they've gone, those that were ready have gone to be with Jesus. To a better place, a better day. And we're looking under my seat. We're looking forward for a better day with Jesus. Down here we go through struggles and trials and situations, hallelujah, in our lives, but one day we'll have a home with Jesus in heaven. Because he said, I go away to prepare a place for you. Hallelujah. He's coming again. That where he is, we'll be also. We're looking forward for that time to come. That's why, hallelujah, Paul let us know, hallelujah, that these light afflictions are just for a moment. Yes, hallelujah, man. Because we're going one day to live with to live with Jesus forever. All we got to do is be obedient to his word. Hallelujah. Live for him. Watch out our, hallelujah, our soul salvation with fear and trembling. And one day it'll be all over. Hallelujah. We'll be able to see our loved ones again. Yes, the Lord. Trials will be over. The tribulations will be over. The sickness will be under my eye. Sickness will be over. Death will be over. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And we'll be able to have life. Eternal life with Jesus. Glory to God. We're so glad that he did it for us. We didn't do it. We weren't able to do it. But he loved us so much that he died for our sins and paid the price that we might be able to go back and be with Jesus when he comes. And we're crying out tonight, and Pastor Ma has cried out tonight. Hallelujah. Letting us know, hallelujah, that it's going to get better. And there's a better day coming. Hallelujah. Yes. There's hope beyond the grave. And in order to have that hope, we got to live for Jesus. Yes, and the minute that he preached to us and told us about, we got to lift up a standard of holiness in earth. We got to live for Jesus. We got to be obedient to the word of God. Hallelujah. The scripture lets us know the word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Hallelujah. We hold on to the word of God. We know that there's a better day coming, that we're going to be able to live with Jesus forever and reign with him forever. Thank you, Jesus. And we're looking forward for that day to come that we'll be able. Hallelujah. To have joy in company in the air. Peace and happiness forever. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. In this world, we have trials and turmoils and situations that we can't handle. But in that, hallelujah, hallelujah, that resurrection day, these bodies, hallelujah, will be, hallelujah, resurrected, hallelujah. Yes, those Lord. That died will be able to be resurrected and go back to live with Jesus when he comes. Thank you, Jesus, Father. God, in the name of Jesus, we're praying for souls everywhere tonight. Yes. Sinners everywhere tonight. Backsliders everywhere tonight. Help us, oh God, to be ready for you. Come in, that we'll see that better day. Hallelujah. Yes, we're so glad, Jesus. He come to know, my God, that you made it possible for us to be able to go back with you and have a better life. All we got to do is live for you. Yes, save you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We pray, oh God, that you bind the enemy everywhere, oh God, that come to hinder your people, that come to hinder the souls from coming to you and being saved. Hallelujah. The Bible says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Yes, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. We're looking to Jesus tonight to bring the victory in the lives of his people everywhere. Hallelujah. Some are alcoholics, some are murderers, hallelujah, some are thieves, but oh God, Jesus came to set his people free, and we command the devil to loose the people, let them go free, that we'll be able to live and reign with Jesus forever. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're looking forward for that great day. We're praying for our children tonight, praying for our young people, praying for the schools, praying for the mothers and the fathers.
Hallelujah.
Praying for the leaders, the spiritual leaders, the secular leaders, praying for kings and rulers, oh God, of our lands and countries, oh God. Help them, oh God, in the name of Jesus to carry out the work that you've given to carry out for you, oh God. Don't let them rely upon their abilities, but let them rely upon them, upon you, Lord, to help them to carry out the assignment that you've given them to carry out. Help us, oh God, to walk upright before you, speak the truth in our hearts, and do the things
Hallelujah.
That are pleasing unto thee. In the name of Jesus, let's give God a praise. Give God a praise.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Strength of God hallelujah. Everywhere. Hallelujah. Let the peace of God rule in us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us stand fast in liberty.
Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Glory, 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 glory.
Go forward. We'll be able to move for Jesus. We'll be able to live for Jesus. Hallelujah. Bless Pastor Jamal, God, tonight. Bless his wife and family. He called my name on the name. He's pouring out his heart on the line. Pouring out his heart on the line that we can be able to receive what the Lord has for us. And be able to go back with you when he comes. We're so glad for everyone on the line tonight. Everyone that have come out, hallelujah. And open up their hearts and open up their minds to receive what the Lord has for each one of us. Because one thing we know, it is getting better and it will be better. Hallelujah. At the end, we go and reign with Jesus and live with Jesus. Hallelujah. Every trial, fiery trial that we go through, it will be worth it all. That's hallelujah. Right. Look on the schools tonight. Look on the teachers tonight. Hallelujah. Those that are working and laboring, hallelujah, in the schools with the children. Help them, oh God. Help the children to be better. Help them to be better. Oh, glory to God. Help souls to be better and be saved and come to you. Hallelujah. We'll be able to have that everlasting life, that eternal life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That your son and died on the cross for that we can have. Oh, glory to God. He comes none of us, see us none of us higher. And we want to be in that number. Glory to God. That John saw a number that no man could number. He comes none of us. We want to be in that number because Jesus died on the cross and suffered that we can be in that number. He come on now, see our Lord of Ohio going back to live for him. He come on now, have your way in us tonight. Bless everybody on the line tonight. The sick, the afflicted, the burdened, the bound, the bereaved. Touch and deliver, oh God, we pray. Those that are wrapped and tied up in sin and can't seem to be, can't get a loose unless you shake them for loose. Help them to be loose from the powers of the enemy and come to you and be saved, sanctified, and Holy Ghost filled, that we'll be able to be better. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Be able to have that hope beyond the grave because we got it. Jesus died for it. He paid the price for it. Oh, we got it. Accept Jesus. Live for him and lift up a standard of holiness in the earth. And he will. Hallelujah. We will be able, hallelujah, to have that hope beyond the grave. God bless you. Back into your hands, Pastor Jamal.
Yes, Lord. Let's give God a praise. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Hey, glory to God. Hallelujah. I got to tell you, eyes have not seen and ears have not heard what God has prepared for them that love him.
Oh, hallelujah.
He has a package for us, an inheritance package that our minds cannot even conceive. God is ready to give us some great things because of what Jesus has done. The Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Well, Jesus did not come into this world to condemn it, but that the world through him might be saved. For the thief come to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I came that you can have life and that you can have life more abundantly. There's good things in store for you, saints of God. You need to be excited. Hey, glory to God, you need to be excited. Hallelujah, Jesus paid the
price.
Jesus paid the price way back on Calvary 2,000 years ago. It didn't look good for him when they were putting him in the grave. Matter of fact, it looked real dark. But in 3 days,
They went to look for Jesus and they could not find the body because he had risen from the dead. I come to tell you, saints of God, I don't know if you're going to be here when the rapture comes. I don't know if you're going to be in a cold grave, your body. But I come to tell you the promises of God are yea and amen. In Christ. And he said he's coming back. Hey, he's coming back for his people. And one day you're going to rise and meet him in the air. And everything that you're going through now, it will be worth it. Because it will be behind you. And you'll have nothing but a bright future of the goodness of God for the rest of eternity. I don't know if you've heard this message in a while, but this is the gospel. This is the good news that joy is on the way. For weeping may for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. You might have sown in tears, but you're about to reap in joy. Oh, God is about to have a party for his people. Hey, I wish I had somebody. Oh, get ready to put your shouting shoes on. Because heaven, we going to have a good time.
Good time. Hallelujah.
Good time. We going to have a time. I'm talking about a good time. We going to have a time. We going to have a good time. I don't know who been sad. I don't know who been sitting there crying tears. But God said, good times are on the way. Hold on, good times are on the way. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but good times are on the way. There's hope. There's hope beyond the grave. All right,
saints. Yes, there is. Oh, yeah.
Hallelujah. Let's give God one more praise tonight. Let's give God one more praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give God one more praise.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Get ready to log off tonight. I'm going to try to round this panel discussion, believers, so we can discuss a little bit of this. If anyone has any questions, you can certainly send questions to jamarfillyall@yahoo.com. That's jamarfillyall@yahoo.com. jamarfillyall@yahoo.com. We'd be glad to answer some questions. We'd be glad to talk about it and discuss. We're going to try to set up a format that'll be very edifying. This book of 1 Corinthians has been awesome. I hope that it's blessed you real good. And just remember that out of all you've been through, that there's joy and there's hope beyond the grave. All right.
Yeah.
So until next week, pray for us, love on us, and we love you, and we'll continue to pray for you. And if you believe in Jesus Christ, as the scriptures have said, then out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water.
God bless you. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of blessing. Out of your belly shall